Hello, SFLogicNinja here, aka David Earl, and this is your tip. All right, let's talk about Logix Compressor for a second. Logix Compressor is actually really good, and they've made improvements over the years and just added more stuff to it. It's really cool, like these circuit types. You know, we have Platinum, and then we have these Studio VCA and FETs. These are all modeled after real-life hardware compressors. The vintage optos like the LA-2A, I can actually bring up a picture of an LA-2A if I just go to my Universal Audio, and I'll pull up a LA-2A. There we go. So this was one of the first kind of compression types, actually, if not the first, called an optical compressor. Pretty simple, just a gain and peak reduction. So the Logix gives you a lot more options than just gain and peak reduction, obviously. You can still adjust your attack and your release. If you wanted this to sound more like a LA-2A, you'd go in here and you'd tweak the ratio to 5:1 and do a couple of other little tweaks just to make this thing sound more like an optical compressor. Then we have Vintage FET, which is going to be like a 1176, which is by UA. Let's see, I'll pull up this one. The blackface. So this is what a FET compressor looked like, classic 1176 type. You had an input and an output. And then we start to see attack and release, which is shaping our transient. And then we have our ratios, which were set 4:1, 8:1, 12:1, and 20:1. If you punch them all in at once, then that gave you insanity to one. Essentially, that's what turned it into a limiter. Nothing would make it beyond, and it sounded really rough and awesome. So that's the 1176, and that's what Vintage FET is modeled after. Vintage VCA, this is more like the old DBX-160. The DBX-160 was the first consumer-available solid-state compressor. It's a very cute little half-rack guy, known for being pretty... Well, the word that they like to use is firm. I think it's pretty heavy is what it is, and fast, insanely fast and heavy compression. Very, very simple controls. But this was, I saw this often used on kick drums and things like that, high transient material. Sometimes people use it in mastering to shave off high transient stuff. And that's what Vintage VCA in Logix is modeled after. And of course, if you wanted the compressor to sound more like the DBX-160, you'd want to look at a real DBX-160 and kind of copy its settings. Under Studio FET, this is Studio FET and Studio VCA. This is when we started getting into looking like the VCA would be like the bus compressor used on SSLG series. If I go to UAD again and pull up SSLG bus compressor, looked like this. Very fast compressor, very clean, usually called the glue compressor because you just put it on ever so lightly and your entire mix would sort of get glued together. It'd sound like all the parts kind of like related to each other a little bit better. And this is usually used on buses that were submixes of instruments, not just on single instruments themselves. Then we had the Studio FET, which I'm guessing that's some kind of manly compressor, which unfortunately I don't have a model of right now. But another really fast compressor, VCA compressor. And there are settings out there for that too that you can look up online and go to town. Really interesting compression types. I'm going to go back to Platinum, though. Platinum is the one that came with Logix. It's the most flexible compressor setting, and it's got a lot of interesting characteristics. Now, I brought up a drummer because what I wanted to show you was some hidden things about the compressor that a lot of people don't know about. I'm going to play this this drummer, and I'm using compression really, really heavily so that we have a really obvious effect on the sound. So it's not necessarily going to sound pleasant, but it'll get the job done. So I'm going to hit play. Now I'll turn the compressor off so you can hear what it sounded like before that. So obviously right now when I pop the compressor on, it's really smashing the entire drum kit and it's not being discerning at all. Kick, snare, everything is being compressed. But when I listen to it uncompressed, it's really just the kick drum that's kind of like blowing me out of the water. So wouldn't it be nice if we could target just that kick and have the compressor pretty much be more discerning about the kick? So down here, look at this disclosure triangle we have. Bet you've never touched this before. Ooh, what do we have here? Lots of interesting stuff. The first one, output distortion. Naturally, this compressor will not distort if it's playing out above 0 dB. But if you'd like to, you can emulate hardware by having a soft, hard, and clip setting for the output distortion. Distortion can be a great characteristic in a compressor, and if you want to explore these different types of distortion, they're pretty cool. But below that, we have something called the sidechain filter. And what we can do is have this compressor only react when it receives a certain bandwidth of sound. So under activity, it's off right now, so it's not activated. I'm going to click listen and basically use this slider to find just the low kick frequencies. Now I got to be careful so that I'm not actually getting the snare as well, because that's what we don't want compressed. We don't want the snare and the other material to be compressed. We just want to be going after the kick drum. So when the kick drum hits this compressor and those frequencies hit, that's when the compressor is going to kick in. Frequencies above that, the compressor is not necessarily going to worry about as much. So we got to try and get it timed so that it comes down on the kick drum but lets the other stuff speak a bit. So let's see how that works by going to activity and turn it on. Now let me show you the difference between that and when we turn it off. Particularly listen to the snare drum. So you can really hear the snare drum comes out in the mix more when we turn on the sidechain filter. And that's because with the timing of our attack and releases on the kick drum, if we get it just right, then the compressor lets off of the kick drum fast enough to let the snare through. And that's pretty cool. So that's how you use the sidechain filter. First you listen, then you turn it on. And then we're just compressing we're only telling the compressor to turn on when it receives a certain set of frequencies. Now next to that, we also have the Q and the gain for the sidechain filter. So I have to keep the Q fairly tight. And the gain was pretty good where it was at. We don't need to boost or cut those frequencies at all. Down below that, we have something called output mix. This is very interesting because essentially what we're given is something called parallel compression. Parallel compression implies that we have a dry signal, like the dry signal of the drummer, and then we have a compressed signal. So what you can do is you can mix those two together. Now, in the old days, the way that you would do it is you'd have your material playing and you'd bus it out to another location, compress the hell out of that signal, and you'd have a dry signal and a wet signal, merge them together so that at the output you'd hear both the dry and the compressed signal. In this case, it's all happening within the plugin, which is pretty efficient. So that's a 50% mix between the dry signal of the drum kit and the compressed signal of the drum kit, effectively giving us parallel compression, or what sometimes is called New York compression. It's very important when you're in Logic to look for these disclosure triangles. they can do pretty cool stuff. For example, if I go to the tape delay, maybe on the tape delay, I might want to mess with the distortion level. Well, we'll save that for another day. All right, have fun with that. Play around with the compressor, and I'll see you next time. Ciao.
Very much like to thank Pyramind for hosting me here once again. I think this institution is really cool, and until I came here for the first time, I had never seen anything like it in my whole life.
What I think really separates us from other people who teach is that we are outrageously passionate about what we do, and especially in electronic music.
Since coming to Pyramind, I've discovered electronic music, and you know, San Francisco being a mecca for underground electronic music opened up so many doors for me and kind of blew my mind.
We cover everything from absinthe to contact. When people get to the mind-melting level, we get into modular synthesis.
Everything about native instruments, everything about Logic synths, down to the finest detail, we learned it all.
The fundamentals of understanding how things work, that's just essential. But then beyond that, there's so much more, and that's where it gets into just a lot of the artistic side of like the creative approach of why you do something, not just how.
There's a lot of schools that just, you know, they focus on the technicality of recording music, but I wanted something that would foster creativity and really help me develop as an artist as well.
Each of our genre-specific programs comes in four levels. There's a basic, an advanced, a professional, and then a master's level. And the master's level is, of course, everything we do. It's the largest and most powerful programs that we can create for you.